Good morning, beloved. We are here gathered in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to worship Him and to worship Him rightly. We know that it's not by any might that we have nor any power that we possess that we're able to worship God rightly. And so we come entrusting ourselves to the Spirit of God, asking Him to pour out His Spirit upon us afresh so that we may worship Him in spirit and in truth. We come on this Lord's Day to worship our Savior Jesus, who is risen from the grave, who is sitting in bodily form at the right hand of the Father, there interceding for us and indeed basking in the worship of His people. And so it is a great privilege and honor for us to be here this morning, and we are thrilled that you have decided to come and join us. On page 9, there's a few announcements that I want to cover before we enter into worship. You'll actually see there two announcements that I want to highlight for us. This evening we will gather for the Lord's Supper during our evening worship service, and so we hope that you'll make special plans to attend. Of course, that service starts at 6 p.m., and we'll still be following those COVID-19 protocols that we have been following throughout this pandemic as we've been back together. Brother Jim reminded me that yesterday, a year ago, was our first time gathering back into the worship of the Lord on the Lord's Day after we closed down for a number of weeks due to the pandemic. And so we are thankful that the Lord has protected us during this year of meeting, and we look forward to His protection and His glory being exalted here amongst us as we continue to worship in person. Also, that last announcement that you see there in your bulletin is a big congratulations to Don Steger. This past Thursday, he stood a good exam, oral exam, on the floor of presbytery. If you don't know what that looks like, it's an oral exam on Bible, theology, church history, the sacraments, church discipline, our book of church order, and the idea of church government. I'm probably missing an exam or two. And it's pretty much a free-for-all. There's about 50 gentlemen there who are teaching elders and ruling elders throughout our region, and they get to ask whatever they please. Don stood a good exam and was passed unanimously there on the floor of presbytery. And you'll see, actually, that his ordination service will be in a few weeks to be the assistant pastor here, to be installed as the assistant pastor here. It's going to be May the 16th. At 5:30 p.m. So that's a Sunday, May the 16th at 5:30 p.m. And there'll be some time of fellowship and refreshments following that service. And so we hope that you'll mark your calendars accordingly. A couple other dates that I want to draw to your attention that's not in our bulletin. There's going to be a chicken bog benefit for our brother Kay McGirt exactly that week, that same week of May the 16th. So on May the 11th, Mr. Henry Brunson is looking for some help in preparation for the chicken bog that will be served on May, cooked and served on May the 13th. And so if you can help with either the serving day or the prep day or both, you can let Henry know, Mr. Henry know, or Allison know, and they'll sign you up for some duties on those 2 days. And so we hope that you can indeed help, or that you would just simply buy plates on May the 13th to help with those medical expenses. And we are so thankful for the Cooks of Christ doing that for one of our own. That concludes our announcements. Let us now prepare our hearts for the worship of the living God.
Thank you.
Our God calls us to worship by His Word, and you see that our call to worship this morning comes from the 108th Psalm, verses 1 through 5. And so if you'll please stand as you are able, I'll read the regular print, and then we'll read together the bold. Our hearts are steadfast, O God. We will sing and make melody with all our being. We will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. We will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is great above the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Let us pray together. Father in heaven, we indeed are here to proclaim that your name and your name alone is to be exalted. Father, we know that it's not by any good work within us that we have the right to be called children of God. And yet, O Lord, in your mercy and in your grace and in your steadfast love for your people, you have taken our sins and cast them into the depths of the ocean to be remembered no more. And as you look upon us here, even in this sanctuary, even in your courts, you look at us and you see righteousness and holiness as we are clothed in the garments of your Son. And so, Father, we give you thanks and praise and adoration for the good work that you have started in us, knowing, O Lord, that you will bring it to its completion. And so, Father, we pray that as we are being sanctified, that you will indeed make us look more like Christ this very morning, that we would leave this place more like Him than when we came. So would you transform us and conform us with our worship and our praise and singing? Would you transform us and conform us as we lift our hearts in prayer together? And especially, O Lord, would you use the reading and the preaching of your Word to transform us and conform us more into the image of your beloved Son? We ask these things in your Son's name. Amen. As we come longing to be more conformed into the Lord Jesus, we know that He is the fairest of all and the most beautiful of 10,000. And so we sing together that first hymn of praise, hymn number 170. Please take your hymn books out and let's sing that well-known hymn, Fairest Lord Jesus.
Thank you. continue on in our worship service, if you look on the second page of your bulletin, we'll see we have a corporate confession of sin. It's good for us as forgiven sinners to still come corporately as a body together to our God to remind ourselves, but also to remind ourselves of the fact that we are sinners. We come to our Father as sinners, but we come as forgiven sinners. But John's first letter tells us we are still to come to our Father and to confess our sins. So let us pray together now using this corporate confession of sin printed on page 2 of your bulletin. Let us pray. Father of mercies, we confess that we have sinned against you. By your Holy Spirit, come and work repentance into our hearts. Help us to see that you are, with outstretched arms, a loving heart, and power to save. Help us to see Jesus, the friend of sinners, and to follow him more faithfully. As we have received him, so strengthen us to walk in him, depend on him, commune with him, and be conformed to him. Give us an experience of your grace that makes us bold for others, that we might joyfully tell our friends and neighbors of your saving mercy. Amen. We have our scriptural assurance of pardon, the assurance that when we come to God confessing our sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive us. In Psalm 103, starting in verse 8, God's word says this: "The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him." Praise be to God. Well, let us again praise our forgiving, merciful, loving God, singing together in our hymnals. Hymn number 87, "The Lord is my shepherd, I will not want." It is during this time that, if there are any children here between ages 3K and second grade, that they'll be dismissed to children's church if you so wish. But let us stand together and sing together, "The Lord is my shepherd, I will not want."
Thank you.
you have a Bible or your phone or the Pew Bible, our Old Testament reading this morning is going to come from Isaiah chapter 14. So Isaiah chapter 14, as we've been going through the prophet Isaiah, we see that God is being faithful, really, to his wayward people Israel, as he had promised them that if they were unfaithful to him, that he would punish them. We've seen him do that. There's been a lot of that going on throughout the book, and we see here now that God, though he has punished his people through the wicked deeds of the nations, we'll see that these nations who have come and punished Israel also will be punished. And we'll see that today with Assyria in general, or specifically. But we'll come to hear again God's word of punishment that will come upon the people who oppress God's people. So again, Isaiah chapter 14, please follow along as we now read God's word. For the Lord will have compassion on Jacob and will again choose Israel and will set them in their own land. And sojourners will join them and will attach themselves to the house of Jacob. And the peoples will take them and bring them to their place. And the house of Israel will possess them in the Lord's land as male and female slaves. They will take captive those who were their captors and rule over those who oppressed them. When the Lord has given you rest from your pain and turmoil and the hard service with which he made you to serve, you will take up this taunt against the king of Babylon. How the oppressor has ceased, the insolent fury ceased. The Lord has broken the staff of the wicked, the scepter of rulers that struck the peoples in wrath with unceasing blows, that ruled the nations in anger with unrelenting persecution. The whole earth is at rest and quiet. They break forth into singing. The cypresses rejoice at you. The cedars of Lebanon saying, since you were laid low, no woodcutter comes up against us. Sheol beneath is stirred up to meet you when you come. It rouses the shades to greet you, all who were leaders of the earth. It raises from their thrones all who are kings of the nations. All of them will answer you and say to you, you too have become as weak as we. You have become like us. Your pomp is brought down to Sheol, the sound of your harps. Maggots are laid as a bed beneath you, and worms are your covers. How you have fallen from heaven, O day star, son of the dawn. How you are cut down to the ground, you who laid the nations low. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven above the stars of God. I will set my throne on high. I will sit on the mount of assembly in the far reaches of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to Sheol, to the far reaches of the pit. Those who see you will stare at you and ponder over you. Is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms, who made the world like a desert and overthrew its cities, who did not let his prisoners go home? All the kings of the nations lie in glory, each in his own tomb, but you are cast out away from your grave like a loathed branch, clothed with the slain, those pierced by the sword who go down to the stones of the pit, like a dead body trampled underfoot. You will not be joined with them in burial, because you have destroyed your land. You have slain your people. May the offspring of evildoers nevermore be named. Prepare slaughter for his sons because of the guilt of their fathers, lest they rise and possess the earth and fill the face of the world with cities. I will rise up against them, declares the Lord of hosts, and will cut off from Babylon name and remnant, descendants and posterity, says the Lord. And I will make it a possession of the hedgehog, and pools of water, and I will sweep it with the broom of destruction, declares the Lord of hosts. The Lord of hosts has sworn, as I have passed, so shall it be, and as I have purposed, so shall it stand, that I will break the Assyrian in my land, and on my mountains trample him underfoot, and his yoke shall depart from them, and his burden from their shoulder. This is the purpose that is purposed concerning the whole earth, and this is the hand that is stretched out over all the nations. For the Lord of hosts has purpose, and who will annul it? His hand is stretched back, and who will turn it back? In the year that King Ahaz died came this oracle, "Rejoice not, O Philistia, all of you, that the rod that struck you is broken. For from the serpent's root will come forth an adder, and its fruit will be like a flying, fiery serpent. And the firstborn of the poor will graze, and the needy lie down in safety. But I will kill your root with famine, and your remnant it will slay. Wail, O gate, cry out, O city, melt in fear, O Philistia, all of you. For smoke comes out of the north, and there is no straggler in his ranks. What will one answer the messengers of the nation? The Lord has founded Zion, and in her the afflicted of his people find refuge." As far as the reading of God's holy word, we write truths upon our hearts.
Let us turn our attention again to God in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord of hosts, as we have just heard, you are the sovereign over all, and even the enemies of your people must quake within your presence, and they must understand that they will be slaughtered for their iniquities. And yet, O Lord, your people, the promise is sure that in Mount Zion, in your house, in your dwelling place, there will be refuge and peace and victory forevermore. Thank you, O Lord, for giving us a foretaste of that heavenly city, that eternal victory that will come. Father, we give you thanks for giving us a foretaste of the heavenly worship this very morning. And as we now turn our attention to your word further being read and preached, we pray, O Lord, that you would indeed give us those ears to hear. As we'll even see here in the parable of the sower, it is only a work of the Spirit that we have those ears to hear. And so, Father, we pray that we would hear you rightly, that it would spur us on to obedience, that it would spur us on to good works, to show that indeed we are good and receptive hearers, and that, O Lord, you would increase your kingdom through the proclamation of the gospel. We know, O Lord, that you will give us the increase a hundredfold, if you will. And so, Father, would you give that increase to us even this morning? For Christ's sake and in his name we pray. Amen. If you'll take your Bibles in your hands and let's turn to Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 20. Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 20. After a few weeks of having missionaries in, it's good to be back into the pulpit to continue our journey through the Gospel of Mark. You see there in your bulletin, we're on our 13th sermon of this series. And again, we're going to handle verses 1 through 20 this morning. But before we read, let me give you a little bit of a reminder of where we have been. This ministry that Jesus has embarked on, and this ministry that Mark is telling us about, being of our Lord and Savior. And it's been quite surprising, if we can be honest for a moment, because those very people who we would think would be the ones flocking to Jesus are the ones that, quite frankly, don't want to have anything to do with him. And it's those others who we would think would flee from Jesus, they are the ones that are coming in droves to him. If you think about even the scenes that we have already undertaken on our Sunday mornings, we've seen people like the religious leaders and the Pharisees and the lawyers and the scribes. They have seen Jesus in the synagogue. And there has been uproars because of his teaching, because of his practices. They have accused him of breaking the law of Moses, those laws that they're so zealous about. And even those religious leaders from the religious establishment in Jerusalem who have been sent to spy on him, they have looked at him and said, you know, he can do these things because he's possessed by the devil himself. And that led Jesus to tell us that parable of sorts, that a kingdom that's divided against each other will surely fall. But probably the most shocking scene that we have handled in this ministry of Jesus is that his own family, those brothers and sisters that he has grown up with, this mother, Mary, that he has been raised by, they see him in the early chapters of the Gospel of Mark, and they conclude that he's utterly insane. And so everybody that we expected to receive Christ has now rejected him, and it's those who we would presume would reject Christ who have responded to him. You think about it. He's healed demon-possessed people. He has, up to this point in his ministry, brought in the lepers and the outcasts. He has called to be one of his disciples a tax collector, a collaborator with the Roman Empire, one that is hated by the Jews. He has called to be one of his disciples Simon Peter, who is a zealot, the scriptures tell us, and that's a radical nationalist who was planning an insurrection against the empire, a violent insurrection against the empire. And yet it's men like these who are now following Christ. And so Mark has painted for us an interesting picture of what one commentator said: the weird and wicked have went to Christ, have flocked to Christ, and the religious, those who have seemed and appeared religious, are the ones that are looking for ways to already put Christ to death to get him off the scene. And you think for a second, how is there these two responses to the ministry of Jesus? We have radically different reactions to who Christ is and who he says he is. They've heard the same messages. They've seen the same miracles. They have witnessed all of the same things, and yet there are these radically different responses to who he is. Well, if you are thinking that, Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 20 seeks to answer that question. Because here it is that Jesus will teach us here in just a moment a parable about how we are to respond to the Word of God, how the Word of God works to those who hear the Word of God preached. And if we can take it a little bit more personal, because not all of us are agriculturally minded here, and so maybe the soil illustrations will get us a little confused. Let's put it in very practical terms. A husband and a wife walks into this sanctuary and hears this sermon from this text. They hear the same preacher proclaiming it. They hear the same words being spoken. They hear of the same Christ being uplifted and held out as an invitation for faith and obedience. And yet, one meets Jesus. One has his heart changed. One responds to the gospel. One bears much fruit for the kingdom of God. One finds that grace and mercy that is enjoyed, that forgiveness that is enjoyed knowing Jesus. And the other looks at him and says, "I don't know what in the world that Matt guy said this morning." How do you reconcile these different reactions? They have the same backgrounds. They are sitting in the same service. They've listened to the same sermon, and yet the response is radically different. How do we account for that? Well, the parable here, Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 20, answers that question for us. And so let us, with that in mind, pay attention to the Word of God. Again, Mark chapter 4, reading through verses 1 through 20. If you don't have your own copies of God's Word or you feel uncomfortable using the Pew Bible, it's there on page 4 of your bulletin. "Again, he began to teach beside the sea, and a very large crowd gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea, and the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. And he was teaching them many things in parables, and in his teaching he said to them, 'Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. Other seed fell on the rocky ground, where it did not have much soil. And immediately it sprang up, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. And other seed fell into good soil, and it produced grain, growing up and increasing, yielding 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. And he said, He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parables. And he said to them, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see but not perceive, and they may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven." And he said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables? The sower sows the word, and these are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground, the one who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy. And they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the world, immediately they fall away. And others are the ones sown among the thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God remains forever and ever. Have you ever had one of those days where you had a list of things to do, or better yet, just one primary thing you wanted to do, but it seemed like everything else in the world was distracting you? Quite frankly, if we're honest, I know that you've had days like that. In fact, we would probably say we have many days and many weeks like that even. And you know how the story goes, I do believe. It's that day at work when you have to get that report done and the phone won't stop ringing and the people won't stop coming by the office just to chit-chat. Or maybe it's the day at home where the kids are spending the day with the grandparents and you think, if I can just get the house cleaned, I would see this day as successful. And yet you do everything but clean the house. Or maybe it's like a road trip and you want to get simply from point A to point B as fast as you possibly can. And detour after detour comes across your route. And you grow in your frustration and you grow in your distraction and you grow maybe even in your anxieties, because it's seasons like this or days like this where it feels like the entire world is pitted against you. You have one goal, you have one mission, and nothing is seemingly going to plan. Everything seems to be pulling you away from that one mission, that one piece of the checklist of the day. Well, I know that's earthly terms, but in a real way, Jesus is experiencing something like this. Now, when we grow in our frustration and anxiety, all the distractions that happen amongst the ministry of Jesus, he sees with compassion and mercy. So don't misunderstand what I'm saying here. Jesus is not growing in any sort of anxiety or anger. But at the same time, there's these large crowds that are gathering around him that are pulling him this way and that way, trying to pull him off from his mission, trying to pull him away from his one mission, to preach the gospel, to lay down his life, to be a ransom for many. How do we know this is the case? Well, we know throughout the ministry of Jesus, he pulls himself away from these large crowds so that he might refocus upon his mission. We know that he, here in our text, even gets onto a boat so that these large crowds might not press against him. There is a lot going on in the ministry of Christ. There's these great crowds that are pressing in against him. And quite frankly, many of them there are for all the wrong reasons. You know, you have the religious leaders, don't you? They're just sitting there with their pen and pad. And they are taking notes so that they might find something to be angry with Jesus about. Something that they could charge Jesus with in the courts so that they may put him in jail, or better yet, kill him so that they can get rid of him. And there are those who are gathered there in the crowd who are just simply seeking to be healed by him, or simply looking to watch some of these miracles, or better yet, maybe, just maybe, he's going to feed the 5,000 today and we can get some free food. There are those who are here for all the wrong reasons. Yes, there are those. Of course, there are those who are there for all the right reasons. They have believed and now they're following Jesus, hanging on his every word out of a true love for him. But in the midst of the good crowd, there are those who are just looking for personal gain. There are those who wish to put Jesus away. They are here to pull Jesus away from his true mission. Jesus, of course, is here to proclaim the gospel of God. He is to teach about the kingdom of light. He is here to lay down his life for his people. He's here to defeat sin, death, and the devil. He's here to be about the Father's business. And he's only here to do the will of the Father. But as these crowds are gathering, Mark implies here that this might actually be the greatest crowd that follows Jesus throughout his earthly ministry gathered here at this point. There are those who are like the bad souls. There are those who are going to reject the word as it's being sowed. There are going to be those who grab hold to the word, and yet they are distracted by the things of the world, and it quickly withers and dies, as Mark tells us. And there will be those who hear and believe and bear much fruit. As Jesus gets into the boat, as he begins to teach there from the boat, some sort of this natural podium probably here at the edge of the sea, he begins to explain for us how the word works, how people hear the word of God. And he begins this, if you look back at verse 3, with this call to hear. With this call to hear. It's actually a double verb, if you will. Listen, behold. This parable begins, even before we get into the first type of hearer, this parable begins with this call to attention, for this call to wake up and to listen, for this understanding, for you to understand what is being said here in this parable is going to require some spiritual awareness. And so the way that Jesus speaks is almost like, listen, consider the sower. It's a call to grab you and encapture you within this story so that you may indeed understand what is being said here. I know I've used the illustration before, but I always love to draw it out as we see this word, behold, because my seminary professor, Dr. Ross, who taught us New Testament and specifically the Gospel of Matthew, he told us that when we see the Gospel writers using this word, behold, it's a call for you to pay attention. It's almost as if the gospel writer is banging on his desk as he is writing. I hope that they are listening as I write this account, as I write this story, as I write out this parable that Jesus spoke. And especially if you were sitting in Dr. Ross's class, he's kind of a loud man anyway. I've never been accused of being loud, but he's kind of a boisterous man anyway. And when he is reading the text, if it comes to this word, behold, he'll scream it at the top of his lungs and he'll kind of pop the podium that he's sitting at. Well, of course, during class one day, there was a student who was not quite encaptured with what Dr. Ross was proclaiming. So he was over there to the side. He was dozing off asleep. That happens in seminary too. And here we are that Mark Ross is reading the Gospel of Matthew and he screams, behold! And our dear brother falls out of his chair onto the floor with a clang. And he said, Dr. Ross said, that's exactly what the gospel writer wants you to do. He wants you to kind of be enamored with what's about to be said. And so he tells you, listen, behold, consider this story about this sower who goes out to sow the seeds. And he tells us about four hearers. But I think that those four hearers can be summarized really into three main points. I want to see the unresponsive hearer, the distracted hearers, because two and three are going to be handled together, and the receptive hearer. The unresponsive hearer, the distracted hearers, and the receptive hearer. Notice if you go into where Jesus is explaining this parable all the way into verse 14, he tells us that there's absolutely nothing wrong with the sower. The sower is here and he is sowing the word of God. That's what we are talking about. Jesus tells us quite frankly there in verse 14, the sower sows the word, talking about the word of God, and he goes about and he freely sows the seed everywhere. To all people, to all places, the sower goes out and begins to spread the seed. Now, if we just simply stop right there for a moment and we think about the Christian mission of going out into the world and making disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, we understand that this means something. This has some application for our mission as everyday Christians, because it's not our business to decide where we're going to go sow the seed. We are to go and sow the seed everywhere to all people. We don't get to say. There's really no reason to go witness to my neighbor down the street. He's an atheist. He is kind of a arrogant man. He'll just kind of challenge me and make me look silly, and I'll be mad at him, and he'll be mad at me. And you know what? I just don't want to do that today. Well, we don't get to say that within the mission of God. It's not our job to determine where we are going to throw the seed. We're just simply commanded to go throw the seed as the sower freely sows the seed here. And so Jesus is giving us this explanation of this parable starting there in verse 14. And he tells us the sower goes and he grabs a handful of seed and he begins to throw it, to spread it amongst the people, amongst the souls, amongst the hearers. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with what he is doing. In fact, there's nothing wrong with the seed either. This seed is the word of God. The word of God is perfect and inerrant and authoritative. It is the perfect revelation, the special revelation of God and his gospel to his people. And so we begin to proclaim that gospel, to teach that word, to gospel the gospel, if we were to get into the Greek language here. It is an idea of gospeling. He uses it as a verb. He says it's our job to go out and to share the gospel. So we have the sower and we have the seed, and both of them are doing what the Father desires them to do. The sower is going out and freely offering the gospel. The gospel is going out unhindered and exactly the way that it is supposed to go. And now we have these different responses. We have the different responses because the seed now, as it's being thrown freely, it begins to fall upon different souls. It begins to fall upon different types of different types of hearers. And so if we move from verse 14 to verse 15, we see the first type of soul. This unresponsive hearer. And so here it is that Jesus begins to tell us that there is a seed that is thrown on the pathway where the soil has become hard-packed and the seed doesn't get to penetrate. It just sits there on top and the birds come and begins to pluck the seed away. And of course he tells us that that is Satan himself coming and taking the seed before it can take root. And here it is that we make this some application for modern day hearers. You know, if we were to encounter those that are unresponsive here in the sanctuary, even this morning, as they leave the doors of the church, they might be able to give you some sort of outline or rattle off something that has been said. And yet, there's no gospel truth that has sunk in. It's like they haven't heard it at all. And so Jesus says that that's Satan who immediately snatches away the gospel. And so there is something of a newsflash here, I think, because Satan doesn't want you to be here. And in fact, he is so angry that you are here that he will try to cause you to stumble into those circumstances of your life so that you may check out during the sermon and have your mind everywhere else as the gospel is being presented. Satan doesn't want you to listen to the word preached. He doesn't want you to sit there with your Bibles open. He is so angry that he will throw out in front of you any and all hurdles to stop you from hearing, from dwelling, from receiving the word. Because he knows that if he can cause you to not hear the word preached and read, that you can't dwell on the word. You can't let that word seep into your soul and cause you to respond to the word. And so he draws your minds to the things that are waiting on you in the office on Monday morning. He draws your mind to that argument that you had with your spouse on the way to church. He draws your mind to, let's be honest with each other, what lunch is going to be when Matt finally stops preaching. He draws your mind to these things so that you'll be so preoccupied with the circumstances that are all around us that you would not notice him coming and snatching away the seed of the gospel that has been sown. And so the command here is, the exhortation here from Jesus is, quite frankly, pay attention to the word being sown. Pay attention to the seed that's being spread. We need to listen. We need to take it in. We need to respond to it. We need to let it penetrate within our hearts so that our heart isn't pavement hard, but soft and ready to receive with meekness the word of God, as James says. And then we come into the second and third hearer with our second main point, the distracted hearers. You continue walking through Jesus' explanation here in verse 16. And he talks about these seeds that are thrown amongst the rocky ground first. And these are those who, you know, it happens here on occasion. You have the good topsoil, but the farther you dig down, you get into the clay and the bedrock. And so your seed cannot go deep within the soil to grab good roots. And so it might immediately sprout, but quickly it seems to wither and die. And we know people like this. Maybe that's even you this morning. You remember hearing the gospel and responding to it immediately. And there was a gladness there. And there was an enthusiasm there. And there was a joy there. And you loved being within the church. And you loved with being within God's people. And you were overjoyed with the promises of God for your life. And yet, what Jesus says when the persecution came and the tribulation came, immediately there was a falling away. And so maybe that was you. Maybe you did respond to the gospel at first and it was such an overflowing moment of happiness within your own heart. But then when the going gets tough, it seems like you fell away. When the peer pressure begins to mount, when the unbelieving spouse gets frustrated, when your boss gets mad because you're living a different sort of lifestyle with different priorities and different ethics. When the pressure mounts, when the persecution comes, that beautiful flower that first bloomed quickly withers away and dies. And if you have been a part of that story, or if you know that story, you know that the temptation is for us to find some sort of nominal Christianity, what one commentator called Jesus light, because that's what we want. We want just enough of Jesus to appease our conscience. We want just enough church to check off the box and say, you know what, I'm a somewhat active member of First Presbyterian Church. We want this superficial Christianity, but when the waves and the winds of the world comes, there's no roots for the word to hold on to, and so you're found with little endurance. But you notice there's a second distracted hearer here, because as Jesus moves from the rocky ground, he then goes to those who are sown among the thorns. So these hearers are not distracted by the persecution and the tribulation that comes often in this life. This hearer is distracted by all the worldly cares that this world has to offer. And it goes completely against what Jesus says when he exhorts his people to do not worry about what you will eat or drink or what you will wear, for your heavenly Father knows those things that you need even before he hears you asking. And therefore, the exhortation is, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things that you need will be added to you also. And so Jesus says there are those hearers that are distracted by the cares of the world. And if you're distracted by the cares of the world, like money and comfort, if those are the first priority for you, you will prove to be unfruitful, because those cares will begin to choke you out. They'll begin to overwhelm. They'll be there to strangle you. They're the epitome of weeds. You know what weeds are here. We deal with them a lot. You can ride down the road back to your home and you can see highway grass, and you can see crabgrass, and you can see chickweed. All of those are in my yard, by the way. If you don't have them in your yard, just drive by my yard. You can see all the weeds that Dillon County has to offer there at 909 McLean Drive. And those weeds will choke out your grass. Your weeds will begin to overthrow everything else that is spiritual about you. The cares of the world will choke out the roots. And when it comes time to be like that rich young ruler, to leave all of the worldly cares behind and follow Jesus, you'll regretfully say, Jesus, I can't. And you'll be found there without your salvation. We need to learn how to fight the cares of the world by faith in the Savior, so that the Word may penetrate deep within us, and that we would first seek the kingdom of God, and then God promises to us everything that we need will be added to us as we bear fruit for His kingdom. And then thirdly and finally, that fourth hearer, very quickly, the receptive hearer. That's the seed that's been sown on good soil. If you'll look back at verse 20, Jesus concludes his parable with this. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word of God and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. Do you notice the marks of the receptive hearer? They are the ones that hear. Look back at the text with me. They're the ones that hear the word, accept it, and bear fruit. And so Jesus is saying, let it go deep within your heart. Let the lasting roots sink deep within the soul, and then you may live a life that is overflowing with abundance of fruitfulness, 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. And so the question this morning for us is that, do we have a receptive heart? Do we have within our hearts good soil for the word to be sown and for us to respond and to hear and to bear much fruit? Well, that's the question, isn't it? As the gospel goes out, as you hear the word of God proclaimed, what do you do with the word? Are you easily distracted by the cares of this world? Or are you allowing Satan himself to go about and snatch away the seeds? Is the seed just bouncing off of your heart because you refuse to listen? When the going gets tough, when the trials come, do you endure? You see, here's how you know you're a good hearer. You're busy pulling the weeds in the garden. You've given up the cares of this world, and you said, if Jesus wants me to have it, and if I need it, He'll give it to me. I'm going to be about the Father's business, just as Jesus declared. You're praying, as the word is about to be preached. Till up my own heart, O Lord, so that it may take root and bear as much fruit as you desire it to be. Are you hearing Jesus call you to follow Him? And are you running to Him and trusting Him? And are you resolving to follow His voice and His call? You see, Jesus, as He concludes this parable there amongst the crowds before He teaches His disciples what this parable means, in verse 9 He says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Well, you see, the crowd that hear is there. They all have ears. They're all sitting there with ears. The seed is being sown. And the question is, what are you going to do with it? Don't fall for Satan's lies. Don't have a superficial faith. Don't be easily distracted. No, hear, obey, persevere, and bear much fruit. That's what Jesus' parable is all about. Well, you might be sitting here, you think, well, Matt, is this some sort of parable about losing your salvation? Beloved, don't miss the point. You can't lose your salvation. Jesus isn't teaching that you can lose your salvation. Don't miss the point in which He is proclaiming. Hear the word of God, receive the word of God, and bear much fruit for the kingdom of God. May it be so in your own heart and life this morning. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we do pray that we would indeed receive the word of God this very morning with meekness, that we would not be distracted by the cares of the world, that we would not allow Satan to pluck away and snatch away the seed that is being sown, but we would be about the Father's business, and that we would seek first the kingdom of God, and so that we may hear, receive, obey, and go out with mission, proclaiming this word to one another, taking that seed that has been sown in our own hearts and sowing it for others to respond, knowing that as we sow, there is always bounty to be enjoyed, sometimes 30-fold, sometimes 60-fold, and sometimes 100-fold. But, oh Lord, let us see the fruits of our labors. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. It's good for us to sing in response to the reading and preaching of God's Word. One of our favorites here at First Presbyterian Church, hymn number 457, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. If you'll please stand and let's sing together as you are able. people of God, receive the blessings of God. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to him be glory forever and ever. Amen.